As the title says, it's going to be a talk that is concerned with some dynamical systems, and billiards are really what things are applied to, but most of the talk will not have anything to do with billiards, but will slowly build up towards some questions in Hodge theory. But since there are billiards in the title, let me just give you one of the typical questions that one looks in this field. So let's say that you take a rectangle and you place this as a Z2 periodic barrier in the plane. These are supposed to be rectangles of the same size. And so let's say that you launch a particle at angle theta for one of the sides, and it starts bouncing around. And so you can call this, so let's say, the flow of the point x in direction theta for time t. And you can ask for a long time how far does this thing go? And so you can take the absolute value. And you can, if this would be a random motion of a particle in the plane, then this, you would expect that this goes roughly to the distance square root of t in time t. At least that's how far the excursions go. But and you can ask, what is the situation here? And it turns out that the exponent is actually different. So let me try to write this correctly. So you take the supremum for little t and 0 to capital T, and then you take a log, and then you divide by log capital T. Then as t goes to infinity, then this will go to 2/3. And the reason why one can compute this number, so in principle, one could show that such a number exists. But it turns out that the reason why this number is computable is, and turns out to be a rational number, is because it can also be expressed as the degree of a certain holomorphic vector bundle over a Riemann surface, over an algebraic curve. And here you would have, so there's a Riemann surface, and it has some other vector bundle over the canonical bundle. So this term is really also just the Weller characteristic of the surface, more or less. But I prefer to write it as the ratio of 2 degrees of 2 vector bundles.
It's for some special values of theta and x.
Yes. So this is for almost every theta.
You could avoid it, I guess. Yeah.
For Lebesgue, almost every theta. So certainly, if you go this way,
yes,
it's going to diverge linearly. If you go this way, it's not going to do much. So this is for Lebesgue.
The size of the rectangle, right?
Yeah. So this is another feature which is a little bit surprising, which is that the sides are actually irrelevant. So it could be that the space between the rectangles is very narrow. And the answer is still the same, actually.
But the conditional theta depends on the rectangles, or?
Yeah, the actual thetas depend on the rectangle. But and I'm going to guess that probably almost no theta works for all parameters. So there
sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say that there are 2 parameters to the rectangle. So I'll get into a moment to a more geometric picture. OK, so.
The rectangle by disks, I get quite a different answer.
Yeah, and it's a problem which is asked and is approached in a very different way. So the reason why, so maybe I, oops, oh, the expensive chalk is gone. So I'll use regular chalk.
This seems to be the wiping up game.
That's knowledge
of us again.
No, it's okay. Right. So a starting point for these kinds of questions were some computer experiments by Zorich in the early 90s. So Zorich's name was also mentioned in the previous talk. So let's say that you take an ordinary topological surface, and you take a foliation on the surface. But now the foliation has to have some singularities. But you take a leaf. So let's say you take again, a leaf of this foliation, and you run it for a long time, and you can ask, what is the class of this leaf? in homology. Now, if the leaf is running for a long time, you close it up in whichever way gives you a closed curve. It doesn't really matter if you close it one way or the other. If the leaf is sufficiently long, this is not going to affect the questions that I will address. So it turns out, and it's not unreasonable to expect, that there's a first order term which tells you that this thing is approximately linear. It represents some homology class on the surface of size t. But what turned out to be surprising in these computer experiments was that there's a next order term. And in fact, the terms went all the way up to the genus. And then there was some bounded error. And so this was already somewhat unexpected. So these numbers, so the first one is 1, it's called lambda 1, lambda 2, up to lambda g. So in fact, what you could do is you could take just any one form on a surface. And if you take a reasonable one form on a surface, then you would have a structure like this. And in fact, the first term will be essentially dual to the cohomology class that you get there. So again, you expect this kind of asymptotics for almost every such one form, in a sense, which needs to be made more precise. But For now, the question, I mean, Zoritz really started with just a single foliation. And he found this structure. What was also very peculiar was the fact that in the numerical experiments, these numbers summed up to a rational number, even though individually they didn't have any structure, except for the first one, which was just 1. And again, the formula that eventually explains this rationality is also of the same type. So they're related to some holomorphic objects and the geometry of Riemann surfaces. So I should also say that the fact that I wrote here a strict inequality is due to Forney. And it's a very useful and important fact that, in fact, you always have this kind of spectral gap in this spectrum. Okay. So now I will try to explain where Riemann surfaces come in. So if you look at the picture of billiards over there, you can try to take a fundamental domain. And the fundamental domain will look something like this. So what you can do is you can glue the top, the opposite sides of this L-shaped figure. And you can glue them using parallel translations. And what you're going to get is a genus 2. So if you think of this as a polygon, and if you identify the opposite sides, what you get is a genus 2 surface. And because the identifications are by parallel translations, you get a flat metric. And the flat metric is just the metric that you see in this picture. However, it's a genus 2 surface, so you cannot really have a flat metric. It is going to have a cone angle singularity at this point. So this is going to be a single point. And the cone angle singularity is going to be of multiplicity 6 pi. So if you add up all the interior angles, you're going to get 6 pi around that point. And so this is a metric picture. And what you can you can also view these things holomorphically. So you can think of omega equal dz. So you view this picture in the complex plane. And you think about the holomorphic one form dz. And if you can descend it to the glued surface. So it will give you a holomorphic one form on this surface on the Riemann surface x. And it will have a 0 of order 2 at the place where this flat metric had cone angle 6 pi. And the metric is simply is just omega wedge omega bar. So it's just dz wedge dz bar in appropriate coordinates. So if I write here, can people see? Or is this good? OK. So what turns out to be useful is to organize all of these objects into a moduli space. So h of mu is going to denote, this is going to be the moduli space of structures that are described on that board. And as you can see, there are two different points of view on this space. So the first one is a collection of polygons. So it's polygons in R2 glued using parallel translations. And cone angle singularities. So the multiplicities should be given by this parameter mu. And the multiplicities should satisfy that their sum is just 2g minus 2. And there's a separate holomorphic description of the same object. So this is just the space of pairs x and omega, where x is a Riemann surface, and omega is a holomorphic one form. And the zeros of omega have multiplicity mu 1 up to mu k. So this is the space that one sort of needs to study. And I'll explain in a moment why is it interesting to look at the moduli space of all such objects when you're interested in, say, a single billiard table. But for this, first, I have to talk about coordinates on this space. So the coordinates really come from this description, this combinatorial picture. And you can see that H of mu has this algebraic structure. So it can be described as, so a Riemann surface is also the same as an algebraic curve, a compact Riemann surface. And the holomorphic one form on it is just a differential. And you can view this space algebraically, but it's rather hard to describe in general in an algebraic way. What you can also look at the space from the combinatorial point of view. And the combinatorial point of view is the following. What you do is you just remember the sides of the polygon that you use to glue the surface. So here, in this case, what you would do is you would remember all of these sides, and you view them as elements of R2. And there are some identifications, so there are some linear relations among these sides. So the coordinates are just the sides in R2, so you view them as vectors, divided up by some linear relations that you impose by gluing. And there's a more canonical way to say the same thing. In other words, here's your surface, and here you have the marked points. So a more canonical way to talk about these sides and linear relations is to say that whenever you can draw a path on this surface, either a closed path or a path between two marked points, you can assign to this object an element of R2. And that number is basically the side. And so this is the same, sort of more canonically, is just isomorphic to the first cohomology group of x with relative to this zeros and with coefficients in R2. Which, again, R2 you can view as the same as the complex numbers. So this is a purely sort of combinatorial way to describe these Riemann surfaces with a holomorphic one form. And it's a fact that these spaces are smooth, and locally you can actually get coordinate systems by using these kinds of combinatorial descriptions. So, the relation to dynamics on an individual surface comes from the following GL to R action. So, if you look at, again, this picture in R2, if somebody gives you a matrix in GL to R, you just apply it. And you're going to get maybe something very skewed. But you can still glue in the same way that you did before. Because if one segment, if this, let's say, if this segment was parallel to this one, if you apply the same matrix to both of them, they will stay parallel. So you can do this action. You might think that when you apply a very big matrix, you've really kind of destroyed the geometry of the surface. But this really doesn't happen. I mean, sometimes it happens, but typically it doesn't, because you're allowed to re-glue. You can sort of cut a little bit and move it on the other side, and you can bring your surface to a reasonable geometry. So maybe the simplest example, so I should say that this just generalizes the usual action on tori. So GL to R acts on GL to R mod SL2Z. So this is this collection when mu is just 0. So when you're looking at tori and holomorphic 1 forms on elliptic curves. So when you look at this action, so the connection to of this dynamics on moduli space, so you have this GL to R acting on H mu. And the connection to dynamics on an individual surface, I'll try to explain just very briefly. It's not going to be so important for this talk. But the relation is the following. So suppose that you just have a torus. So I'll draw it in this way. So I rotated it a little bit, because suppose that you're interested in understanding this curve, this vertical curve, on the torus. So suppose that you launch this vertical curve. So if you rotate by the appropriate angle, you're just looking, instead of a vertical curve, you're looking at on the regular square on at an ordinary curve. So now suppose you want to understand this curve and how it's going around the torus. Well, what you could do is you could apply the matrix GT, which is e to the t, e to the minus t. And what this will do is it will shrink the curve, but move around the torus somewhere in the moduli space. So if you think about this picture in parallel, so if this is the modular surface, then you're starting somewhere here, and you choose some direction on the modular surface, and you launch a hyperbolic geodesic, which is moving around your modular surface. And the behavior of this hyperbolic geodesic in this moduli space will tell you about the behavior of this single vertical curve, very long vertical curve, on a fixed torus. So the simplest feature is, for example, if the geodesic is very deep into the cusp, it just means that some point in here, some point up here, after you apply this matrix, it gets unusually close to the origin, for example. So there's a whole dictionary. And my talk is not going to be about the dictionary, but rather about one side of the dictionary. And it's the side that connects to Hodge theory. OK, so this is moduli spaces and why they're interesting. So the first main important result about these spaces, due to Mazur and Veach independently, is that there exists a natural, there exists a finite Lebesgue class measure on H mu, which is also SL to R invariant. So what I mean is the following. In fact, which measure you have to take is obvious. There's, because of these local coordinates, there's essentially a unique measure class if you normalize it. There's a unique measure up to scale that you can choose. I switched here from GL to R to SL to R because GL to R, the scaling part, just increases the area. So you normalize to area 1. So from now on, I'll only talk about SL to R. But the key word here is finite. So the fact that you have a finite measure is what is important. And the consequence is that you get lots of consequences for almost every x omega. So what this tells you is that for a generic choice of surface in this h of mu, its orbit will be very nicely and uniformly distributed in this moduli space. And so in particular, this will allow you to say all sorts of things about behaviors of geodesics on these surfaces. Now, the only problem is that, for example, if you're interested in billiards, billiards inside this moduli space are a set of measure zero, of Lebesgue measure zero. So only certain Riemann surfaces will come up from billiards in some polygons. So oftentimes, you want to make a statement about a concrete billiard table, or for example, one that you have over there. And those are a particular smaller dimensional subset of this moduli space. And you know, everybody can say that almost every real number has an equal frequency of zeros, ones, twos, and threes in their digits expansion. But nobody can say the same thing about pi, because yeah. So the typical type result of this type is Ratner's theorem, which really allows you to classify the dynamics of certain groups really for every point. And so in this field, the result which is analogous to this is due to Eskin, Mirzakhani, and Mohammadi. So what they showed is that for any x omega, if you look at its orbit closure, so again, I'm going to take GL2R just for simplicity. So if you take its orbit closure, x omega, it's equal to some set M. But this M is, in fact, a linear manifold. So I'll explain in a second what is linear about this manifold. It carries a finite Lebesgue class measure, which is automatically ergodic because for the action of SL2R and so on. What does it mean that the manifold is linear? So linear means that it's cut out by linear equations, so by real linear equations in these coordinates. I didn't probably give them a name, but they're called period coordinates. So in these coordinates, in these relative cohomology groups, and it's in these coordinates that come from the combinatorial description of the surface, so from these kinds of coordinates. So the ambient space, as I said, has this other description as an algebraic variety, meaning that a Riemann surface is an algebraic curve, and you can look at the collection of all algebraic curves equipped with a differential of a certain kind. And so one thing that you can prove using Hodge theory is that, in fact, these manifolds, these linear manifolds, are actually described themselves also by certain algebraic conditions. So M, a linear manifold like before, is also so it has a natural structure of algebraic variety. In fact, it can be cut out with polynomial equations over the algebraic numbers. And moreover, it is characterized by certain Hodge theoretic conditions. So this is where Hodge theory comes in. So what kind of Hodge theoretic conditions can you see? So the first one is about the Jacobian. So it says, I will not be very precise about the actual conditions because I'm not sure if, I mean, I'm happy to tell you more if you'd like to hear it. But the Jacobians of these Riemann surfaces and the homomorphic one form, they have extra endomorphisms. And in fact, omega has to behave in a certain way with respect to these endomorphisms. So I'll give an example in a moment. And there's also a torsion condition. Torsion condition on the zeros. So it really depends on the size of the orbit closure. So if the orbit closure, if M is everything, then there's no extra endomorphisms. If M is of the smallest dimension, then you have a lot of them. So I'll try to give an example. Yeah, so the typical example is that you have so you can have real multiplication. And another possibility, again, in some sense typical, is that you could have it could be reducible. For example, every time you have one orbit closure in one genus, you can do a covering construction, and you get another such orbit closure in some higher genus. So you have a surface which just covers this other dynamical system. And this will be reflected in the fact that the Jacobians on the cover will have to split in a certain way. Right. So this is the first condition. And the second one is the torsion condition on the zeros of omega. And again, the smaller m is, the more conditions it has to satisfy. Because these conditions, these Hodge theoretic conditions, sort of cut it out of.
Torsion in the Jacobian.
Torsion, yes. Torsion condition in the Jacobian. And in fact, in a factor of, for example, if you do a covering construction, you can only say something on a factor of this Jacobian. So let me try to give you an example, which was known for a long time, and in fact, this theorem is. These results, in fact, the theorem should be kind of read backwards, meaning that first you prove that these kinds of statements hold, and then you conclude that M is also algebraic. And because if you assume that M is algebraic, then with a little bit of work, you can conclude this. But if the dimension of M is equal to 1, then the above is due to Martin Muller. And essentially, what happens is, and when the dimension of M is 1, you know abstractly that M is a finite volume Riemann surface. And if M is a finite volume Riemann surface, then it's in particular an algebraic curve. And a lot of the techniques in Hodge theory apply. And you can conclude all sorts of good things.
This M is sitting inside a bigger.
Yeah, so it sits inside this big space. But all you need to know is, if the dimension of.
You need to know the dimension of this closure. Is M an M?
So this is the same M as the linear manifold. So if the dimension of the orbit closure is 1. So.
Where we're sitting originally.
Sorry. Yeah, so maybe I should quotient by the scaling. There's a C star scaling on the one form. So really, this is what I mean. This should be one dimensional.
In this curve, this Riemann surface, is this a Veitch curve in that case?
Yeah, so in that case, this is an example of what's called a Veitch curve. So the classical example is if you take the decagon. So I think it's easier to draw a decagon by just drawing a circle. But let me try to draw this. Oops. So you take a regular decagon in the plane, and you glue the opposite sides. So if you do the gluings, and the opposite sides will be parallel and of equal length, then you're going to get actually two distinct points on the boundary. So there will be two zeros. One is this bigger circle, and then the other one is, this is also a point. So you have these two zeros, and if you glue them, you get a genus two surface. So if you call this P, and P modulo these identifications, is going to be a genus two surface, and with a holomorphic one form. And for this particular picture, you can actually write down what the algebraic curve is, which represents this one form. So you're going to have y squared equals x to the fifth minus 1. So you see that this has a tenfold symmetry. And there's a hyperelliptic involution, which descends x to minus x. So it's the central symmetry. But then there's a rotational symmetry. And the omega will be x dx over y up to scaling. And what the theorem, which was in this context due to Muller, so is the following. So, well, Veitch showed that the stabilizer of this x omega, so let me call this maybe x10, of this x10 inside SL2R is gamma 10, which is the which is a triangle group. This is the 10 infinity infinity triangle group inside SL2R. So it's gamma 10 inside SL2R. And so this is, and in particular it's a lattice.
10 means the angle is 2 pi over 10.
Yeah. So this is the angle here is 2 pi over 10. And in particular, what Muller's theorem in this case says is the following. So, what Veitch said is that he exhibited explicit matrices, in fact, generators for this group, such that if you apply them to this polygon, you can re-glue the new polygon back into this one. So, for example, a rotation, you can see the rotation, and in fact, there is some extra symmetry. There are actually some shears that will actually preserve this polygon. And so you can have explicit generators. So this is something you can verify by hands. What I have no idea how to verify by hands is the following statement. If you take a small matrix in SL2R, you apply it to this picture, then the new algebraic curve, you don't know how to write this new algebraic curve. And more importantly, what is still going to be true is that the Jacobian of that algebraic curve will have real multiplication. And the difference of these two zeros will still be arranged in a special way in this Jacobian of the algebraic of this new curve, which is given to you in this kind of flat picture. And so in principle, you have this flat picture, and it's not at all clear how to explicitly exhibit all of this extra structure that you know has to be there.
So this Muller theorem says that every Veitch curve is algebraic, that's what you're saying.
No, so every Veitch curve is algebraic.
Kind of a Q-bar.
In particular, it's going to be defined over Q-bar. So the definition of a Veitch curve is taken to be that the stabilizer is a lattice.
Yeah, I'm trying to understand what Muller's theorem is saying.
So Muller's theorem is saying that over this, so you have over this H mod gamma 10, you have a family of algebraic curves, which is obtained by applying a matrix in SL2R to this curve, and to that picture, to that polygon. So what Muller's theorem is saying is that this each of the fibers of, you know, for any of the Riemann surfaces in there, the Jacobian of that specific curve will have real multiplication, and moreover, these zeros. Well, the difference of these two zeros will continue to be a torsion point on the Jacobian. So this is what Muller's theorem is saying. And the content of the previous theorem is that the same kind of behavior happens in all higher dimensions. So, okay. So what I'll try to do now is maybe I'll try to describe the what are the key tools and some of the other applications. And then if I have some time at the end, I'll try to say a few words about the proof. So the key tool, but in a slightly different form than the way is it's used classically, is so as I said, so the key tool is trying to bring in some Hodge theory, and there's something called a semi-simplicity theorem. For variations of Hodge structure, and basically in the algebraic setting, so once you know that the base or the place where you're looking at your variation of Hodge structures is a reasonable manifold, so this was done by Griffiths and extended also by Schmidt, and in the algebraic complete algebraic setting, so when you know that these variations come from geometry, there's also due to Deligne. So what these theorems say in the simplest form is the following. So if you have your cohomology of your Riemann surface, then you have a decomposition like this. And suppose that, so you have your M, and you have your H1 that, say, lives over here, then H1 is what's called a flat vector bundle, or also known as a local system, meaning that two nearby fibers of this vector bundle are naturally identified because you can just look at the topological picture. However, inside you have this H10, which is a holomorphic subbundle. And the first one form of these theorems says that if you have V inside H1, a subbundle, a flat subbundle, then two things have to happen. First of all, V has a complement, so you can take its orthogonal complement, or there's a natural metric or a pairing, and you can compute. So it has a complement, but more importantly, both V and V perp respect the PQ decomposition, meaning that each of these vector bundles, also flat vector bundles, so purely a topological input. So if you somehow, by topological means, manage to construct a flat subbundle, then these flat subbundles are forced to have a decomposition of this type as well, which is kind of a statement now in analysis. And so the setting in which these theorems are usually used is when the base, this M, is known to be, say, an algebraic variety. So these statements are definitely false locally. So they're kind of global results. So unfortunately, as I said, what one has to do is first prove these conclusions, so prove that these conclusions hold, and then conclude that M is algebraic. So one cannot go kind of the other way yet, at least. It's not clear how to establish a priori that these things are algebraic varieties. But if you can show that these kinds of statements hold, and then you can pin down what M is and then identify it with this algebraic set. But so the way to prove it is in this context is using the SL-R action. So you can prove it using this SL-R action, and I'll try to maybe sketch a proof in a simple case closer to the end. But what is also particularly useful is that you actually get a version which is different from the classical version. So you get a version that's not implied by the usual version. So in what sense?
Prove it means
Yeah, this. So what do I mean by a different version? So here, so if you imagine that this is your M, so M is kind of foliated by these SL2R orbits. And so I should say, maybe as a side remark, this SL2R action on H of M is not holomorphic. In the sense that it's not a holomorphic self-map. For any, if you fix this element, an element of SL2R, you apply it to this complex manifold, the self-map you get is not a complex holomorphic map. So in any case, you have these SL2R orbits. And what the usual theorem says is the following. Suppose somebody gives you a vector bundle over M, a subbundle of H1, which is invariant by parallel transport. So if you take a path on M and you move using parallel transport, this vector bundle stays invariant. And so suppose you you're given such a data, then the conclusion is that it has a complement and there's a Hodge decomposition, and the complement itself is also going to be flat. Now the theorem, the version which is useful, is particularly useful in dynamics, is the following. Suppose that the data is not a vector bundle which is flat over all of M. It's flat only when you move along these orbits. So if V is an SL2R invariant bundle inside H1, meaning that you can move, if you parallel transport along these only these kinds of paths, then the bundle stays invariant, then the same conclusions hold. And the point is that there are examples of vector bundles, which are in fact not even holomorphic on all of M, which are invariant in these directions, but are not globally invariant. And using these kinds of bundles, you actually have sort of applications to the actual dynamics. So some applications of these results are of the following type. So the first one is that so I want to go back to Lapunov exponents. Actually, before I state the theorem, let me just remind you. So we had these numbers, lambda 1, lambda g, that I talked about in the beginning. So these are so how do you obtain these numbers? So what you have to do is the following. So here's M. And you take a random geodesic. So you take gt. Again, this is the matrix e to the t 0, 0, e to the minus t. The reason it's called a geodesic is because this is a geodesic for the Teichmuller flow. So for the Teichmuller metric, these are going to be geodesics. And what you do is you take a vector in this h1. So this is the bundle h1. And what you get is a decomposition. So h1 decomposes as h lambda I from minus g to g with the following property, that if a vector v belongs to this h lambda I, then the limit as t goes to plus or minus infinity of, so you take the, so you start with a vector in here, and you can start moving it along the geodesic. So the geodesic is moving around your space. And you're parallel transporting your vector. So you're applying basically monodromy matrices to this vector. And if you're applying these monodromy matrices, you expect the vector to grow at some exponential rate. And these numbers, lambda 1 through lambda g, measure exactly this exponential rate. So you take the log of this v, and then
you. Something that's for every point or almost every point?
Right. So So what is true abstractly is that it is this thing holds for almost every point. What turns out to be true, and this is a result of Chaika and Eskin, is that in fact this holds for every point in almost every direction. So you can take r theta to be cos theta sine theta minus sine theta cos theta. I think this is the rotation matrix. So it's true for every point and for almost every theta once you conjugate gt by this almost every theta. So this is, I mean, this is what's true, but this is a strengthening of what you would have in general. But in any case, you measure this exponential growth rate, and this is what these numbers give you. And so a kind of informal way to say it, to say the conclusion. So for applications to dynamics, it's important to know when these numbers are equal, or for example, most importantly, when are they zero? So if they're zero, then there's no growth rate, and then you can be in trouble. And so the theorem is that so all zero exponents are accounted for by just monodromy and basically Hodge theory. So what do I mean by this? So the way I wrote these exponents here, I wrote the first g, and then I said that the other g exponents are the negatives of the previous ones. So you have this symmetry because your h1 has a symplectic form. And if you have a symplectic form, then basically you're moving things around by a symplectic matrix. And if you take the logs of the eigenvalues of a symplectic matrix, then you're going to see this kind of symmetry. So here, a typical kind of situation where you could have zero exponents is, let's say that you have a monodromy on a piece of your monodromy in U1n, then what you get is that the exponents are essentially zero, except for just one. So here you'll have n minus one zeros. And in fact, you can have unitary groups with arbitrary signatures. And you know that there are at least this many exponents, but these inequalities are never strict. So it could be that this number is itself zero. This happens occasionally in dynamics. And what the theorem says is that, in fact, once you know what the monodromy is, you cannot have more zero exponents than are allowed for by the just the geometry of the situation. Okay, so this is one kind of application which is sort of more analytic in flavor. And another sort of application is to finiteness results. So this is So if you have your manifold M, then over it you have this vector bundle H1. And basically splitting of the Jacobian is the same as saying that the monodromy has to have some kind of splittings. So I'm talking about the monodromy of this H1, of the cohomology of the curves, of the Riemann surfaces, as it's seen over M, not over the entire space. And maybe I should say that there's a version of all of this, not just for H1, but for relative cohomology groups, where things are a little bit more technical, where you have to allow for, where you don't have pure Hodge structures. So there's an extra version of this. And this is particularly important for the finiteness results, as this is joint work with Alex Eskin and Alex Wright. So maybe I'll only state the theorem informally, but let's see. Okay, so let me say first the following. So Eskin, Mirzakhani, and Mohammadi showed something a little bit stronger than just the fact that every orbit closure is nice. they showed that if MI is a sequence of such orbit closures, then there exists a subsequence of these things, such that the subsequence equidistributes in some ambient, in sort of some bigger orbit closure. Under SL2R. So this is everything. In fact, they're the same. So there are several theorems, but what I mean, orbit closures could be either of the two. Yeah.
In your applications, you probably start with something not fully.
The unipotent stuff. Yeah, so for applications to ergodic theory, you probably really need the P invariant stuff. But here, so this is kind of essentially a purely topological state. I mean, for this application, in fact, just the purely topological stuff suffices. So it's just saying that if you have a sequence of orbit closures, the only thing they can do is that they can be dense in some bigger such orbit closure. And what we showed is that, so there's an invariant. So each MI has a certain invariant that's called an algebraic Hall. So this is really an invariant that comes from dynamics. So it was introduced by, indirectly, I mean, it appears in the work of Margulis, but it was formalized as a definition by Zimmer. And so this is some invariant which, in the context of Hodge theory, you can think of this as some kind of dynamical Mumford-Tate group, where it's some kind of, so it's the symmetries of a typical, so it measures the symmetries of a typical symmetries of the typical x omega of H1 of x omega, really. So you're really looking just at the cohomology. So this is some invariant that comes from essentially, so this is in fact a purely dynamical invariant. It makes sense in other contexts. But what we showed is essentially two things. One is that if mi equidistribute to m in that sense, then what happens is that the algebraic Halls of these MIs also equidistribute to, sorry, eventually agree with this algebraic Hall of M. So if you have an infinite sequence of manifolds, then you can ask about the behavior of this invariant. And what this is saying is that eventually it has to agree with the invariant associated to just the limit. And the second one, the second fact is that we can compute it. Compute the algebraic Hall of such a thing. And the corollary is that, and the corollary I'll have to state in a kind of informal way, is that there are only finitely many in any genus so I'm going to call them unexpected orbit closures M. So
Yeah, so
yeah.
I think he's got a question.
So yeah.
The algebraic Hall is a
Yeah. So the algebraic hull is in fact a real algebraic group, and
some kind of closure or some group somewhere.
The way Zimmer defined it is the following. So you have this these kind of monodromy matrices, and you can ask, but there's kind of a dynamical way to think about these monodromy matrices, and it's asking what is the smallest algebraic group that you can conjugate all these matrices into simultaneously. And part of the reason, by the way, that we can compute these kinds of things is also because you can ask what kind of conjugacy do you allow. So if you allow measurable conjugacy, in fact, you can do much more. So for example, if you only consider the group GT, then you can actually always essentially diagonalize your, because of this oscillator's decomposition, you can always just diagonalize your, locally, your monodrome, your cocycle. But if you look for the full group SL2R, then basically there are some other things that you cannot see at the level of monodromy, but there's nothing that you can kind of don't expect. And so an algebraic hull, in fact, the right way to say is that the algebraic hull is a conjugacy class of algebraic groups, meaning that in each fiber you have an actual group, but they're all only conjugate to each other. There are maps between them, but not actual, a group has to live somewhere. An algebraic group has to live inside something, and you have many candidates where it could live. Yeah, so this is how Zimmer defined it, where you kind of take a measurable trivialization and you do all sorts of things. But this kind of this is one definition, but it's not the most practical one. So there are some other definitions. So unexpected. So for which curves, the statement is the following: many people try to prove is that there's something called algebraically primitive ones where you have real multiplication on the entire Jacobian, not on just on a factor. So of those, outside of genus 2, you only have finitely many in any genus. In fact, if you have real multiplication of a factor on a factor of dimension 3 or more, there are only finitely many. So you can have a real multiplication on a factor of dimension 2 on an abelian surface, but those come in only finitely many families. And they're all, and outside of that, everything is a covering construction.
This is not proved by any diagonal method. I mean, it's not that.
Yeah, so this is really proved by this kind of equidistribution type statement. And I guess in the homogeneous space setting, there are these results of Andrea Ward type where if you have not just points but something bigger, then you can get it from homogeneous arguments. So I think the time that I should have started, an hour after I should have started, I don't remember exactly when I started. So maybe I'll stop here, and I'm happy to tell you more about the actual proofs that come up in Hodge theory in private. Thank you.